I'll take you through SRF's journey into shared services and setting up the shared services. Inertia, he mentioned the point inertia, and that's a very critical point. And I think older the organization, the more is a particular state that organization is in, a state of inertia. And to change that requires a greater push. And when we were doing chemistry and physics, to make an electron jump a orbit, you had to give it a certain quantum of energy. If you didn't give that quantum of energy, that jump from the first orbit to the second didn't happen. So the older the organization, the more entrenched the organization is, the greater is the quantum push that you require. Just to start, SRF is a very old organization. So we had, we had naturally a more difficult time trying to do it, but I'll share the journey in all honesty and being fully candid. And I expect that at the end of it, maybe it'll excite you enough and provoke you enough to ask questions as to how we handle different situations. Now, it just so happened that the presentation, this thing is not moving. So, again, you need to build contingency plans. So, I have my contingency plan here. So, the PPT is not moving. And I'm working with my phone where I have the presentation. Okay. Basically, I'll give you one slide on the background of SRF so you get the context. And after that, I'll take you to the journey as to the steps that we followed and how we executed and the challenges that we faced. So it's a very very succinct and short presentation. SRF was established in 1970. It's a pure manufacturing, multi-product, brick and mortar, multi-locational company. So that adds to the complexity of what we wanted to achieve. And it's not a service organization, it is not financial services, it is not a telecom company. The other characteristic of the company was that it was, when it grew organically, it grew in silos. So each business, and thirdly, each business was different from the other. So first two were chalk and cheese, and the third one you can call whatever you like. Right? So they were so different. And each grew organically, and the CEOs were totally the kings of the hill. So whatever they purviewed, whatever they surveyed, they were the kings of that. They set up their own processes, their own systems. Practically, SRF was and still is. It has three verticals, CEOs being the head and all powerful. So it was three companies going around masquerading as a one company, right? So it was only at the apex that everything used to get put together at the head office, what was called as a head office. So in this context, trying to shift processes from nine different locations, three different businesses, people who are used to their own independence and putting them into one box naturally posed its own set of challenges, which was different from any others. So, I had been actually thinking about doing this for a very long time, and every time I spoke to the leadership, I spoke to the managing director, there was reluctance. There was not reluctance in the agreement. There was no reluctance in the concept, agreeing to the concept. The reluctance was, is this the right time to do it? And every idea has a time and place. What is suitable for a big organization may not be suitable for another organization. Maybe the gains to be had are not that many. Maybe the existing state or point of departure as it is so fixed that there is very little to be gained by fixing it any further. And basic American concept of if it ain't broke, why fix it? So why do you unnecessarily go and actually turn a screw inside a, you know, open up a machine? So the time was not right. So we didn't, but last year, something turned. What turned is we became more global. So we had 13 plants, 9 in India, 4 overseas. We became more global. More importantly, our vision became more global. Our vision became more dispersed and our vision became more diversified. So then I took a proposition to the management saying that if you want to grow, if you want to have at least your backbone which is scalable, right, then you've got to assess whether this is the time to make the transition. And if you agree that is the direction you have to go, then this is the time you need to make the change, even if it doesn't give you immediate gains. It is the future that you look at. It is what this change will do for you in the coming years rather than what it will do for you today. And if you have to make the change, make it now rather than 5 years later. Because you would have lost the benefit of gains during those 5 years. And this thought, I think, gelled with the managing director. Mine is a promoter and company. And by and large, which is not entirely true, we are all quite independent. We believe we are independent. But by and large, what the promoter family thinks sways. They are fair enough, broad-minded enough to accept inputs. But once the input is taken, synthesized in their minds, and a decision made, by and large, we follow that decision. So, while the decision-making is democratic, the execution could be autocratic. So, which helps in this whole process as well. So, it is autocratic democracy. Okay? So, now, having said that, we took up a proposal to the board and said that how to, now, part of the knack, which part of little bit of my gray hair and 35 years in the industry has taught me that if you want to sell a proposal, the key is how you navigate it. How do you navigate it internally? How do you get enough momentum going so that everybody actually selling your proposal for you and you are then thereafter not trying to sell it on your own? So we got, the fair thing to do was, I was also actually not sure that whether this is the right time and whether it is at the cusp and it will actually, the decision will fall whether to set up a consolidated center or not, whether the decision will be in a yes or a no. So we found a consulting agency to do a feasibility study. And that feasibility study, in all fairness, was presented to the management saying, this is what outsiders have found, the state of affairs in the company, and if you were to go for a centralized thing, this is what the result would be, and this is, we leave it to you to decide. So it was not anybody's baby being projected, it was statement of facts. The management team actually took up and decided to go ahead, and that's where we got the buy-in for the senior management. And thereafter, what actually happened is it became a institutional project rather than a CFO's project or a finance project. And we built on that and we said we don't want it to be linked to finance. We want to give this unit certain independence. So the future thinking and the future structuring was done in a manner that this is not a finance project. I'm just one of the leadership team members selected to execute it. And the management was also left to outsiders. The other thing that was required is what should be the structure, the first point on the slide. Should I outsource it fully? Should I do it fully in-house or should I try and do an hybrid? Knowing the company and the culture in the company and the thinking, outsourcing was a complete no-no. And then the question arose, do we have to do it internally? Do I have the competence? This BPO, unlike what, or business process outsourcing, or when you consolidate this, unlike what many people think, it's a highly specialized process. It has its own set of skills and expertise that is required. So we decided that we will not do it fully in-house. We'll do a hybrid. We'll get the experts from outside. The employees will be ours. So the people who manage it and the people who run it will be people who have experience in this field. So it will be, the top part will be outsourced, but the investment, the infrastructure, the employees will be ours. And even in the employees, what we said, some employees will migrate from existing businesses, some will hire fresh, and some will hire fresh on a temporary basis, on a contractual basis. So that provides us the float that as we become more expert and efficient, I can do away with this employee strength. So it gives you that flexibility in the total employee headcount that you actually have. Then the second part came of making the project and implementing it. So we got the same consulting agency which was there earlier to do a study across the plants. They had done part of it as part of the feasibility study, and they did a fresh thing of process mapping. And the other thing is, like I mentioned, our not only businesses were different, our processes were totally different in various plants. In various businesses, the processes were different. In the same business, in various plants, the processes were different. So trying to put it all together, so there was a good schematic done, and we tried to use our re-implementation of Oracle as an excuse to make the processes uniform. So we actually hid behind IT, something that was happening in IT, we used it as a shield to say that we want to make other processes uniform, and IT requires that it be changed. So there is some little bit of wisdom that needs to be used there. Then the processes that we selected were easy to the, you know, low hanging fruit, which offer themselves globally for transitioning to such consolidation. So that accounts payable, payroll processing and bank reconciliation, and by nature these are transaction oriented, and you do the same thing the same way again repeatedly time and time over again. So after all this was done, the company decided to invest in a real estate. So the company that way had actually declared its stake in the project by saying we will buy the property. We are not going to go hired. We are not going to take someone else's premises. We bought the premises, we furnished it, fitted it out, put the capex, actually put the money where the mouth is. And hence, the commitment of all others who were seeing this happen, the demonstrative commitment, demonstrative effect of this was far larger across the organization. So naturally, there are challenges during execution. Nothing goes as planned. And there are real issues and real challenges, real concerns that happen. People feel threatened. Sometimes there's a turf war, no matter how much the buy-in is. Suddenly the CEOs, the CFOs of every business feels a whole chunk of people, whole chunk of work is kind of going away. So that took a lot of kind of convincing that this is not what it's going to be. You'll retain your power. We are only processing guys. You need to devote your energies to doing something better, and so on. We formed a steering committee which used to monitor regularly, and the consultants gave help in making this whole thing. They provided the governance on how the process will flow. So we've been emphasizing on the rigor and discipline of process. So the consultants provided the rigor on how the process of planning and execution will be carried out. Then we got the site ready, we got it implemented, we hired people well in advance, gave them 60 to 75 days training. I cannot say with confidence we did it in the best way. We attempted to do it in the best way. I don't think we got the best outcome. We commissioned it but the good thing was we started on 1st April in real seriousness, and we implemented the shared service on 1st September. So going through all the loops, we still implemented in 1st September. If we had delayed it by a month, it's a questionable thing whether I could have improved the execution, the implementation. But we wanted to make a statement. We pushed it through. We are going through teething problems over the last 2 months between September and October and partially in November. There are training issues. There are little bit interpersonal issues in the set of people that you've put together. There are interpersonal issues from the units. There are education and training issues at the units between the SPOC and the hub. So those things happen, but they are not unsurmountable issues. They are real. You live in a real world. These things happen. But we were so determined to commission it on 1st September that we had an alternate to the entire site, that if the site doesn't come on, so finally the limitation was whether the IT will be in place, the connectivity will be in place, whether the desks will reach there in time, whether the furniture will be there. We had an entire backup that come hell or high water, the center or the processing will start on 1st September. Once that was done, actually everything was available at the center on 29th August. We inaugurated the center on 1st September. I don't know whether the standby would have worked that we had in place, but it had to be, the bluff had to be called and the standby had to be kept. So I mentioned during this time that what are the challenges, and I don't think any of these challenges can be cast aside or should be underplayed. The fact is, these are real challenges. And you have a set of employees who've been working in a particular way for the last 20 years. There were certain basic procedural changes, practices. We had to scan documents, which were all new things which were happening. There was a lot of logistics involved. Fact is that it was happening across locations. But I think all of us are working because the sunrise, the future sunrise is much brighter. Because tomorrow, it's only not these three processes, it is more processes that can be shifted, more processes in finance and accounts, but bigger processes in whether they are HR, whether they are, someone mentioned data analytics, whether that it is analyzing big data, whether it is creating models, sales models. The benefit of doing such a thing is it is totally scalable. Tomorrow, our units in South Africa and Thailand can be plugged into this. It's absolutely plug and play once you've got it stabilized. So it is the future which attracts us rather than the benefits that we derive today, because it's a small organization. So we've got 35 odd people. So it's not, earth shattering kind of a shared service which was set up. But once South Africa starts getting processed here, Thailand starts getting processed here, the scale, size, the enormity, the change, the impact, all of it will be a lot different. And the other key thing that we derived is we've put a lot of control and compliance. Like Mr. Ramesh said, I'll sleep easier if I know things are being done in a particular process, and that process has been vetted 10 times to make sure that it is the best, most robust process to exist. I believe that if you have a good process, no matter what you put in, you'll get a product which is as per specs. Because what you put in will also pass filters prior to being put in. It will change the degree of control and compliance, the effort that goes in, the MIS that you can generate out of that, the cost that is incurred to do it, the reliability, the consistency, the uniformity across units. It will be a sea change compared to when we were doing it in a distributed manner. Now we are in the process of determining metrics. How do we measure? How do I set the baseline? What is considered old hat and what is considered improved state? So all that we are in the process of setting up, measuring it, and then setting new benchmarks. So the real key lies in how you define those benchmarks, how do you set those standards. And mentally, it's only by coincidence that I'm a CFO. It's by qualification I'm a chartered accountant. But mentally, I'm an IT guy. And IT is going to be totally disruptive. What you do today, you can take it from me, you are not going to be doing tomorrow. You are not going to be doing it in the same way as you do it today. So the agility of mind, agility of processes has to be part of the design. And agility of mind has to be part of the design of the hiring that you do. The people that you hire have to be mentally agile. Only then can the processes be agile. Only then can you think in the forward space. Three basic concepts which are going to actually impact everybody. One is death of time and death of distance. Two, death of time and death of distance. No matter where the activity takes place and where it actually gets processed, where the transaction takes place, where it gets processed, is totally unrelated. The second is when it gets done and when it gets recorded, that window has become very short. So this total death of time, total death of distance. Keep this in mind, and what is affecting this are three things. The cost of communication is coming down, it's crashing. The cost of memory is crashing, and the cost of processing is crashing. Now, when these three things coincide, you can imagine the potential that it unleashes. It is the new technology in energy, incidentally, is fusion and not fission. Nuclear again is old hat. People are now getting on to energy which is derived from fusion, putting it together rather than splitting it. Except that they have not been able to handle the temperatures. Similarly, if these three things happen, the cost of memory, cost of communication, and cost of processing, the sheer brute power, it will change dynamics. Keep that in mind, and I think then fresher and fresher, and this will not only improve existing processes, it will open avenues of what new can be done in a similar environment. What all can be put together, R&D, someone mentioned, we are putting processes around R&D and we do basic core chemical R&D, high level chemistry, chemical technology, white coated guys mixing liquids. But around that, we've put a process. How will the product be developed? And it is almost like transactional. How do you protect the data? It's a process, and hence the discipline around security, everything. So things will change. Young people here, you can be certain that what you have learnt today is of no use even 10 years from now. Thank you very much, and thank you for your patience.